Welcome to the Fuel Up Podcast, guys. Today with us, we have Soham, Bhavneet, and we have a new entry with us, which is Aditya Srinath. So, Srinath, would you like to say a few words before your first Fuel Up Podcast?
I'm excited for this. I think this is a platform for ranting about just it's a space for pure thoughts. So, I want to talk about
pure discourse, man. Like, you can just go for it here.
As long as you know.
And this is where, you know, all of our thoughts come to like a it's a unified place for all of our thoughts, where we can judge people openly with our, and people who listen to us can also judge us based on our views.
Yeah.
And looking at the topics we have in line, I think we have a lot of controversy.
There's a lot of a lot of judging. So I'm going to start with the best topic first, and this topic keeps coming up with all of us. And I mean, so it's DC design, and now DC design has been around for a very long time. And so Dilip Chhabria, I'm sure he's a good designer and everything. He's worked with Chevrolet, and I think he did a few touch-ups on the Chevrolet Beat, which is actually a debut car. But other than that, whatever I've seen has been just hideous. Like, I think the first DC car everybody saw was the Tarzan, which looked cool at that time. But if today, like, you try to picture it, like, no, that car is not practical at all. Like, what is the point of it? And the cost of that car was 2 crore rupees, and it's based off a Toyota MR2. So just let that sink in. I mean, good business, man. Like, you gotta earn, I know that. So I want Soham to go first and like tell his views about the DC design and especially the DC Polo.
Oh God. I mean, I have never I agree. Like, the Tarzan was kind of cool. Like, when we saw the movie, it was crazy. But I've never personally liked anything from DC design. Especially the Polo, man. Like, I don't know how much was the kit. I forgot. So it was quite expensive, and
it's 8 lakh on top of the car.
Oh God! So 8 lakhs, and like, just think about the amount of modifications, actual proper modifications you can do with 8 lakhs with a Polo. Like, it's crazy. So I mean, first of all, I don't know about his designing, man. I think he's a really good businessman. Like, I'm going to give him credit where it's due. As a businessman and like as an entrepreneur, he's good. Like, he has a lot of other businesses which are quite successful, and he's been doing them for quite a long time. But when it comes to designing cars, I'm sorry, dude. Like, I hate his designs. First of all, they're expensive. They're really expensive. Second, they look hideous. That Polo, whatever that thing he made, it was absolutely hideous. But I think so the most common car or common thing from DC design you see is that that duster thing with those lights up front. I think so. I've seen those a lot. But yeah, man, I don't like DC design at all. What about you, Srinath? What do you think?
I just feel some of their designs, they couldn't stop designing. That new DC Avanti, if you can call it new, I don't know what's new about it, but the Rare, they couldn't stop designing it. Ek layer yahan pe, ek vent yahan pe. They open and they can brand, there's a crease here, there's an angle here. They couldn't stop designing it. And to begin with, I didn't like the Avanti. I don't know about the other people, but I don't know. Okay, there's a market for it. Let's be honest here. There's a whole new market for it. And especially their Innovas and their lounge edition, you know, in the cars people VIPs use. I think there's a market for it. But the rest of the stuff, I'm not into that kind of stuff. No. And you can't, I feel bad calling him the best designer India could, you know, offer. You think about it.
What about you, Bhavneet? What do you feel about DC?
Well, taste is very subjective. We're going to start with that. India has really subjective taste in that bracket itself. And I mean, he caught on to people. He caught on to people that actually wanted something really flashy. And India, and here in India, flashy stuff always sells. Few of us car enthusiasts need to bleed our eyes whenever we see something like that pass by. But like, what can we do? Some people are actually really enjoying this. And taste, it all comes down to taste. And some people like it. Like the Tarzan car, I actually thought it was bloody mad when I saw it. And I was a kid living in Spain. So like, for me, that was still cool. And now that I know it's an MR2, it kind of pops a bubble. But I'm good. DC did a good job. I saw the new Rolls Royce that he turned out to a 350Z, 370Z. Was it for that Prince of...
No. It was for an Indian businessman. And he had commissioned it. Like, a lot of people said it was for the Sultan of Brunei.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
that guy has like 7 F40s, man. Why would he ever get that done? Like, but there's a guy who's...
F40s that weren't commissioned by Ferrari. So why would he go to DC?
No, but I think so. That has to be one of the worst... I don't know. What do you say? Like, I think... in the car industry, man. Like, first of all, like, see, I'm not a big fan of Rolls Royce, but when you go out and take like one of the most like opulent cars on the road and you get inspired by a cheap Japanese sports car and just morph the two designs into something so ugly and so disrespectful to both communities, man, it's just horrible. I don't understand, you know, like how that was acceptable. And the Indian businessman who commissioned it, man, you should get a slap to your face.
Okay, that's really...
okay, but like... I don't even think like that was the worst. That was the worst, to be honest. Have you seen that Thar redesigned? Has anyone seen the Thar redesigned? Okay. So, you know how when you're really young, and you go to these amusement parks and like you get those small cars to drive around in like for 10 bucks an hour, which have the pedals in them and they're like bulbous. It's literally that. And on top of the 10 lakh rupee Thar, it's a 7 lakh rupee kit. And I mean, I just want somebody to go Google it. Like, you can just go Google it right now and see the DC Thar.
Is it this?
Oh, no. That's not it, bro. That's not the DC Thar. Type DC Thar yellow.
Oh, no.
Didn't I describe it so aptly?
Yes. This thing, right?
Yeah, that is it.
That has the saddest face for any car.
Oh, God.
Crying.
I mean, I don't even know, man. Like,
it looks like a Chrysler... What's that called? A Prowler?
PT Cruiser.
PT Cruiser.
Prowler. It looks like that.
Actually, Hamad was very... he was very accurate with his description. Because in my mind, I was thinking, it can't be that bad. No, I was like, but no. This is probably worse. If I was a child, if I was forced to sit in this, I would probably cry.
Oh my God. Okay, so I think... we'll move on to the next topic because this DC design bashing can go on forever because almost every design is like this. Yeah. So, I think the next thing I want to talk about is the Skoda VRS 245. And, I mean, already there's like a lot of... the cars are just delivered, right? Like, both Soham and Bhavneet have just gone to the Skoda dealership in Pune. So, I don't want to talk about it too much first. I want... Aditya to go first on this topic.
Oh, resident VRS expert.
Yeah. So, okay. Yeah, go ahead.
I think there's only one criticism we all have. It's the absurd pricing. I mean, how can you spend 45 lakhs on a front wheel drive car? And again, the best part, this is the old version. There's a newer version. There's a better version out there. But you know, you got the older version. And slightly better than the BRS 230, because in the end, because they were struggling to sell it, they were selling it for 25, 24 on road. So there's a 20 lakh difference between what the 45 lakhs you can buy and the 24 lakhs that you got before. And I think that's about it. The pricing is the only problem here, I think. Because at 45 lakhs, you're looking at BMWs. And is the VRS badge that dear to you, that 45 lakhs is worth it? Or because the 330i in the same price range, it's hell of a deal. You're getting a BMW in the first of all, you're getting a BMW. Every time you bring your VRS around, you have to explain it to your friends. It requires an explanation. Why did you spend 45 lakhs on a Skoda? And because it looks so subtle, every place you go, not many people will know about it. That's good in one way, but when you're spending 45 lakhs, I think you don't want to be that subtle.
What about you, Soham? What do you feel about it?
Yeah, I agree. Like, the biggest issue with that car has to be the crazy pricing. Like, 45 lakhs. I mean, I agree with Srinath. I would for sure go for a 330i or something. But yeah, I think so. The basic charm for the first, when the 230 came in, the VRS 230, I think so. The basic charm was it, like, it was not expensive. It was like in a decent range. Like, you could either, when you're thinking about that price range, you're thinking about either a Superb or this. And I think so, this was a better option because, like, you obviously had the normal creature comforts, and after that, you still had a powerful engine and everything. And you were getting a new car. Like, in 30 lakhs, I can think of a lot of performance car, but they're obviously secondhand. But yeah, I think so, that's where the Octavia VRS 230 was actually really good at, was where it was priced at. But yeah, man, I think so, the main reason why it's so expensive is because it gets the same, it's obviously imported and it gets the same gearbox as the Golf R. I mean, all of the people who've driven them, they've said like there's no apparent difference in between both cars, like they're almost identical. But it's just a little like small changes here and there. So yeah, I mean, 45 lakhs is just too expensive. What about you, Bhavneet? What do you think?
Well, you and me have seen it in flesh. To be honest, I really like it, but I wouldn't pay 45 lakhs for it. Just like everyone agrees. But after looking at it in flesh, if you have like 45 lakhs, a 3 series that would be fun to drive and nice would be around what, 50 lakhs on road?
I'll check. Yeah, just check what's the on road.
But if that's the case, then the VRS kind of makes sense, but you still have all the drawbacks. You have to explain it to everyone. You need to still try to, like, you'll be subtle, but like no one's gonna notice. And if you don't get it in lime green, in that cool as green, I'm pretty sure like it's just another VRS. And if you don't want to spend that much money, you can just get a Superb and get a tune up on it, and it'd still be much cheaper, and you'll have like quite a lot of power still.
No, but okay, if you wanted the VRS, obviously you want a performance car, something that could handle well, that something that could handle the performance. Superb is too big a car. But I'll give you one more perspective. Okay, the BMW 330i is the other extreme. Now think about the normal Octavia, the LNK. It has the 1.8 TSI, which is essentially the same as the 2-liter TSI. The 2-liter has a bigger stroke or more, I think. It's essentially the same engine. Even the cooling system, everything is the same. Yeah, so.
It has a different turbo.
But the on-road price for a VRS, for the LNK Octavia, the 1.8, it's 22 lakhs.
Yeah.
Now it's, yeah.
I think so. Like, yeah, you can do a lot of stuff to the 1.8 LNK, but you get a different gearbox, you get different suspension, you get a different turbo, you get better internals. So like, but 45 lakhs is not justifiable at all. That's for sure.
I mean, if you spend 10 lakhs over the 22 lakhs of the LNK Octavia, I think you'll have a car that performs as good as the VRS.
But that'll be stock, right?
It'll maybe see you can push out around 350 horsepower, reliable horsepower. People can go mad with their car and they can go 500 horsepower. But 350 is an achievable number, and with APR like you can basically they're ready fixed parts. So with those parts and with a tune, I think 350 horsepower is an achievable target. And that sense, I don't think 45 lakhs is too much. 10, 30 lakhs on a normal Octavia still is as good as VRS.
Yes, Bhavneet, go for it.
Slightly off topic, Aditya, are you gunning for 350 horsepower from your car?
Okay.
I only expect one thing from my car now. I had a lot of expectations, but I think I'm down to earth now. I only need my car to work. I need my car to be a car.
Listen, I need my car in the garage. I can't find a good.
Could you repeat the voice? I couldn't hear you.
Even my car's in the garage. First of all, it was missing oil. And then after that, I needed to change my cooling fan, and now I'm struggling to find one.
Oh yeah, cooling fan, they do demand the. And this VAG, the car, the problem with VAG parts, because every time you bring your car in, let's say my VRS, okay, my Mark 1 VRS, people think I'm rich also because it's a Skoda. When you say words like Skoda and VRS and Octavia, people think you're automatically rich. Even though I got this car for 3, people think I've spent 15, 16 lakhs on this car, a lot of money. So they don't, I want the OEM providers. And their parts are super expensive. The cooling fan, the cool I got for 19,000.
It's not bad.
For my car. Yeah, so you know what I've done to, see that the thing with, if you don't have money, you come up with Jugaads. So I've given a direct connection to my fan with the direct, every time I start the car, the fan is in full speed. There's no speed variation.
Yeah. Okay, so coming back, what Hamad asked, the 330i, normal without the Ansport kit and all of that is like 41 lakhs. So, X showroom. So, on road, I'm guessing it's like 46, 47-ish. So, yeah. But, yeah, in that price bracket, 330i for me, I wouldn't get a VRS 245.
So, what I find, you have a my take on this is like, it's all well and good, man. Like, I think Skoda knows very, very few people are going to buy these. And, like, if you have a small market, why not like put 45 lakhs on it? Like, people have still bought it, right? Akoya Skoda has how many drivers coming in? Like, more than 10, right? If I'm not wrong.
Yeah, no. 20. It's not only Akoya Skoda. It's like across Pune. So, like, they're saying they've allocated 20 for it, and which is really weird because it's more than Mumbai, which is kind of weird. Like, I don't think 20 people are going to buy a Octavia VRS in Pune. Especially for 45 lakhs. Really weird.
Oh, God.
Yeah, but they've allocated 20 to Pune. Whereas Mumbai has 12.
Wow. Yeah, so in a way it's worked. But then like I think like that was also their goal in a way to make it like any sensible person would be like 45 lakhs. Oh, I'm not going to buy that. If you actually want to spend 45 lakhs, the BMW, I think how much is the C-Class for? It's also in that same bracket.
Yeah,
you can go for that also. And then, like, a lot of Indians really, really care about the badge. If they didn't, like, brands like Mitsubishi would still be a thing in India. But this is exactly why they're not a thing. Because people, Audis are a big favorite of people in India. Like, people junk them after 3-4 years, but that's a whole different issue. So I feel like, yeah, in a short number, but, like, it doesn't make sense for anybody else. So the next topic is a little long and like it concerns 2 or 3 cars actually. So first we'll start with the BMW 4 series. And Soham was doing a live recently and he very interestingly mentioned a very, I guess it's poignant that the big grills in BMWs, they have actually been inspired because like people in China love those big grills. And here's a very big thing about the Chinese market. It's so big on luxury cars that the Rolls-Royce Cullinan, it was just made thinking about the Chinese consumer in mind. And I think there was another post we did on our own Instagram handle. It was about how the C class and the A class are getting these long wheelbase models because China, of course, it's a communist country, so they will charge you on the CC of your engine. So, like, a C class will obviously come under a much smaller tax bracket. Hence, it makes sense to offer it in a long wheelbase. Their obsession with, like, big, like, grill big, car big. So, this is obviously affected because, like, the whole market. Now I'll tell you what my take on that BMW grill is. Honestly, it's a really, really iconic piece of motoring, that small grill. And now it's an eyesore. And I've seen, like, TV journalists try to defend it, saying, oh, no, you'll just get used to it. I mean, no, like, it's so hideous to look at. Like, it can easily go wrong. So, first, like, Soham, like, give me your...
I hate it. Currently, I hate it. But I actually disagree with what you've just said, like TV journalists trying to defend it and all. So I'll give you an example. Like when the new generation of McLarens were coming out, like the 720S and the Senna and all of that. When I first saw the 720 and the Senna, I was like, what the f*** is this shit? Like, it's so hideous. But like as time went, you know, like they start to become like kind of more acceptable, I would say. So, I mean, currently at this stage, it's ugly. Like, don't get me wrong. I absolutely hate it. But I think so BMW know what they're doing. And it was either just keep the same design and, you know, like, just be as simple as possible or else go for something bold and something new, try out something new. So, I think so they went for the second option, obviously. So, currently, it is an ISO and I think it'll be an ISO for a long time. It's not like all cars have always, like, you know, like aged well or something like that, but currently it's really bad looking. And yeah, coming to the Chinese market, I mean, almost all car brands are just gunning for the Chinese market, man. Audi makes like A3 sedans, long wheelbase for that market, and like they just like big things for some reason. Like I don't know why, but it's just what it is. And it's kind of sad because they like SUVs first of all. And that's one of the biggest reasons why SUVs are becoming a trend all over the world. They're absolutely hideous. Like the Aston Martin DBX, Lamborghini Urus, Bentley Bentayga, they have no reason to be alive. None at all. I mean, apart from, you know, like generating sales. But like in terms of like the company's heritage and history, they have nothing to do with that at all. So like it's kind of sad to see like people getting in like the trends of, in the automotive community currently. What about you, Srinath? What do you think?
Again, my views might be unpopular here, but I'll just tell you this. I think how much longer can they go with the smaller kidney grills? I mean, we've already seen the smaller kidney grills for a very long time. I agree, this is probably one of the ugliest cars I've seen in my life, and it's hideous, obviously. But they had to make this move because you can't progress with the same old smaller kidney grills in the future. Now, I'll give you another perspective. The Audi RS2. The genuine Audi RS2, we all love it. But remember, it only had a small rectangular grill in the front. Look at Audi's now. It can swallow you in whole and still, it can swallow everything on the road. But we have sort of got used to it. Now, Audis are known for the big grills. Take anyone that Audi on the road and it's instantly recognizable. It will take some time, but I think it's ugly. But maybe in future, we can see decent looking car from BMW, and they had to make this move. I feel it's not just purely biased with the Chinese market, because BMW as a brand, they know they have a lot of enthusiasts following them. But I think I think they just went big with this instead of going home with this.
Bhavneet, what about you, man? What do you think about this whole big grill thing?
Those big grills, no. I think what BMW's done is they were really poor spec out as a launch. And if they would have changed a little bit, you know how when you like sometimes don't like a car at first and then you see a really nice spec of it and then you like try to start leaning in towards the car and like it even more and more, and then yeah, you get the shape, you understand what the design is, and then it's not like ugly anymore. I'm pretty sure slowly when some better specs come out and cars, those cars actually start look like, wow, that looks actually mad, then yes, then people are just going to stop looking at it like a copying thing. Like even the Panamera, when it launched, it was disgusting. It looked like a whale trying to eat something. But then like it turned out to be a little more sleeker and sleeker. And with generations also, it turned out to be nicer. Maybe they start this generation and by next year they have an update because it's so gopping. And I hope that's the case because it's fucking ugly.
Okay. So now here's my problem with all this. So Bhavneet gave a really good example of the Panamera. And I remember everyone being like, oh yeah, what is this? The same thing happened when the Cayenne had come out like 6-7 years earlier. But here's the thing. When you sat in that Panamera and you drove it around, people loved it. That's how it shot up. That's not this. I mean, I've not heard anything. I mean, forget the 4 series. I think it's still forgivable. Like, I understand like what someone's saying. Like, maybe tomorrow you wake up and you're like, okay, maybe this is fine. But the 2 series, right? It also has these same design cues. And like the Panamera example, everything is forgiven if that there's that performance and there's that prestige of the car. But now, and this is a very crucial point for BMW, because I'm sure all of you have been following, sales have been falling like crazy, and Mercedes and Audi have totally capitalized on this. It's like an open secret. And another thing which went really wrong for BMW was they tapped into the electric market at a very weird stage and with a very weird strategy. So they launched that i3 and i8. Like, we don't need to talk about how unsuccessful they were. So I think like here BMW is like really trying to cement an image of like, you know, so I think this is like a new image. Like, I mean, I see what Aditya and Soham are trying to say. Maybe tomorrow you wake up and you say, yeah, okay, maybe it's not that ugly. But there's a second part of the problem, which is like, the performance is not that great. Like, you don't hear anybody comments, oh yeah, that 2 series, oh man, it's so good. You know what? You should just buy these 2 series. And I get the whole logic behind that also. It's the same logic they used to sell classes, cars like the A-Class and everything. So, I mean, it's not problematic as of now, but then the whole problem becomes like, is the car any good? You know, like the grill is just like, so a very big reason why people bought BMWs is because they look classy. And that small kidney grill, I mean, yeah, aesthetics change. Like, just as we began with the podcast, tastes are pretty subjective, right?
If I say it looks like Hitler's mustache?
I mean, it was not big, right? I mean, I don't think that's offensive, but like. God. Yeah, so I mean, I don't know where BMW is going. Like, what's the direction you're headed in? Like, I think, okay, like the 4 series is also fine, but that 2 series, what is that about, man? Like, it looks like a Verna with a body kit. Yeah, Srina.
See, no other car, at least in recent times, none of the cars have actually begged for this much controversy. The reason being, BMW's is actually, it's a brand known for enthusiasts. BMW also has this loyal fan following. If you buy a BMW, keep buying BMWs. And regardless of how good the car is, how bad the car is, people still buy BMWs. I think this hit the fans harder than most of us people. End of the day, we are not going to buy this car anytime soon. Okay, and this is not going to affect us in any way. BMWs, for some people, are these people who own the E90 editions, who own the E46s. For them, it's a very big transition from going from such a small grill to a big grill. The same thing with the Supra. People are questioning why Toyota went with the BMW engine. But eventually, as people started to prove its power output and power gains, we are okay with it now. So I think this is just a matter of pleasing the enthusiasts and the purists. And that would take some time.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a very good example, actually, because now you barely hear anybody crib about the Supra being a BMW underneath. So I think we'll move on to the next topic now. It's about Maruti introducing their own leasing. And it's a good step in a way. The thing is, like, Hyundai already has this, and I think you can get a Santro is the cheapest car. You can lease a Santro for 7,000 rupees a month. And except Maruti and Hyundai, you have a Zoom car, Drive Easy, and another platform. I keep forgetting its name. They all offer cars up to like Scorpios, and you can even rent Skodas. And like the cheapest car I found was the Suzuki Swift and the Hyundai Santa. Suzuki Swift you can get for like 6 grand. And I think that's the cheapest. And the highest I've seen is like cars going up to 18-19K. And like they're called subscriptions. So I think this is also in view with the coronavirus, because things are going to change. Like people are not going to buy cars how they used to. So Soham, I want to know your views on this first.
I mean, a lot of brands have been, you know, trying to fool around with this concept for quite a long time. So Cadillac has been trying to do this in the USA for quite some time with like their, you know, like you get the car, then you use it for a month or so, you put X amount of miles or kilometers on it and you switch it out. So this concept has been there for quite a while. Porsche has been trying to do it. And yeah, I mean, if you think it from a consumer point of view, like, I mean, all of us over here are enthusiasts. Like, we want to own cars and all of that. But as a business and as like a consumer, I mean, I wouldn't mind it actually. Like, you're getting a new, if you're talking about the subscription service, you get a new car almost every month. I'm talking about Cadillac and Porsche. So basically in their subscription service, you get a new car every month. You pay normal insurance regardless of what car you're driving. They have a basic insurance rate, so you don't have to keep on changing your insurance and all of that. And yeah, I mean, it's pretty convenient, and they like servicing, you don't have to care about like once your subscription's over, they give it out for a service and all of that. So it's a pretty good thing. Would I personally go for it? I don't know. I can't really say, but like if it's actually something which is beneficial and is, what do you say, like comparing to like actually owning a car is kind of on the same kind of price bracket, then why not? Like maybe I would. What about you, Srinath? What do you think?
Okay, let's purely talk business here. We all clearly know Maruti know how to sell a car. They've been ruling over our country. You can see a Maruti every 3 seconds. So they clearly know how to sell a car. And this is purely a business move, and I'm pretty sure they're gonna, you know, mint money out of this. This is, again, it's been profitable in countries like US. That's pretty popular. People don't buy expensive cars there. You can actually rent out, you can lease out a S-Class, which is much cheaper than owning an S-Class. And you don't have to deal with the problems of depreciation. You don't have to pay insurance for it. And end of the day, if you damage the car, they give you a new car. And if you are part of this lease program for a very long time, they'll give you upgrades. And end of the day, you can get in and out of this car. You can own this car without doing it, without having the problems of owning this car. Purely business point of view, awesome. But because it's Maruti, anything Maruti does, it kind of creates a trend for every other manufacturer, then they are forced to follow suit. Now, if other manufacturers don't follow suit, they're losing out on that kind of market share. And this is, and most of our Indian audience, they are passive versus performance people. They need the car to be economical. They don't want it to be fast or fun at all. It's only a machine for them, for taking them from point A to point B. So this is the cheapest way for them to own a car. Obviously, they're going to fall for it. So bye-bye, Swift Sport RS.
Abni.
I'm going to try and argue with the lease program and try and find a bad point. The only bad point I'm thinking of is being limited, because I'm pretty sure when you subscribe to one of these cars, you will be given a limit of kilometers, and you would be paying above, you would be paying extra for every kilometer ahead. Plus, you'd be paying fuel. So the aggregate cost per month would get quite high. I mean, in a Swift, I'm pretty sure if I'm driving, I would pay another 3,000 rupees that month for fuel. So it's 9,000 rupees a month. And if I cannot afford a car first, those 9,000 rupees, I'm pretty sure are going to be quite tough on you. So a bike still is an option. And people who own cars and actually drive a lot and cover a lot of kilometers still don't go for that, still wouldn't go for this and still prefer to own a car, because then the freedom is still quite open. Yes.
Yeah, no, even I'm actually thinking about it right now. I really don't know what kind of market they want to tap into, because yeah, what Bhavneet said is actually kind of true. In India, the people who can't afford cars go for bikes. And if you can't afford a car anyways, I mean, like, the thing with the subscription and leasing and all of that, like, it's going to be around the same kind of, you know, like, money that you have to pay for maintaining and owning a car, except the initial costs, like, you know, like the down payment and all of that. You might not have to give that, but then, like, you're right, like, monthly, weekly, whatever you're doing, it's going to be as expensive as, like, a normal car ownership experience. So I really don't know, like, what kind of market they're tapping into. And currently in India, I think so, it's still much more economical, safer bet in general just to own a bike. And especially with cities like Pune, which are getting, like, a good metro service right now, like, the metros are being built and everything like that. I mean, mainly, if you think about it, these subscription and leasing service, they make sense if you're only driving inside the city. Like, if you're going to do something like intrastate or something like that, it's really stupid, because you'll just exhaust all of your kilometers, which you have, you know, like, you can use in, like, a few trips. So I think so, when it comes to that, I really don't know what kind of market they're tapping into. But if there is, like, it's Maruti Suzuki, so they must be thinking about something. I really don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the whole, I think the most surprising part was, like, even the secondhand cars, I think the true value cars, they're also going to be offered like this. So it won't just be new cars. I'm sure, like, they must, I mean, we don't have the numbers yet, because this is a very new thing. I mean, it's not even finalized. Like, the leasing programs with Hyundai and Zoom Car and everything, they've been done. Again, the numbers are not out on that. So, Howdy.
Post-lockdown, I'm pretty sure no one wants to drive a car someone else has driven and owned for a month.
Yeah, they're doing the whole cleaning and sanitizing thing. So, let's see. I mean, post-lockdown, also the thing is, everybody's been affected. People don't have the same kind of purchasing power anymore. So, either it's that you take Ubers every day, which people keep changing, or you go for a car which gets a cleaning once and then you own it. So I think people have to make choices, because, like, right now it seems like that's a soham point. Maruti Suzuki has thought of it, and, like, they barely want to change anything. Like, airbags was not even on their minds until, like, 2012, 2013. They're like, oh, maybe we should put it, you know. Maybe people don't want to die. Who knows? So, like, yeah, if Maruti Suzuki is doing it, I mean, let's see, right? Like, Maruti Suzuki always changes to the needs of the consumer. Otherwise, it doesn't change. They just want to save money, and that's all they want to do. So, yeah. Does anyone else have anything to chime in on the whole leasing thing? No. Okay. So, the next thing we're going to talk about is, this will be more specific to Soham and Havneet, I guess. Soham, you can go first. Since you reviewed the Karoq, how is it pronounced? Karoq.
Karoq.
Yeah. And I saw the review. It was a good review. I really liked it. But I couldn't help notice the comments which kept flowing in. Like, some were just ridiculous. I mean, it's a good review, man. Watch it. You don't want to buy the car, don't buy it, bro. It's like some people are like, oh my God, why are you doing this? And, like, so, I mean, I don't know. It just didn't make sense. So I want to know from your perspective, like, first of all, how was the car actually? And would you actually buy it? Because, like, I mean, it seems like a good deal.
See, the thing is, I mean, it kind of sounds hypocritical, but I wouldn't buy it actually, because, like, that's not what I want right now. But the thing with the comments is that, first of all, like, everyone is just like, I don't know, man, Indian car enthusiasts, car nuts, whatever you guys are. I mean, you have to stop being so anal about every single thing. Like, it's just stupid. Like, he's like, oh, Endeavor gets this and that. And I think so. I'm pretty, like, what do you say, straightforward in saying, like, this car cannot do what, like, a Jeep Compass or what an Endeavor can do. Like, I've said it properly. I haven't tried to, you know, like, put some masala and butter saying, yo, it's an off-road monster or something. It's not meant for that type of consumer. It's meant for that old man who's wanting to buy an Audi Q3. He doesn't have the money to buy an Audi Q3. So he just goes and buys this. This is a better option to that. And more importantly, like the Jeep Compasses and whatever it competes with, they just don't have the same build quality, the fitment and all of that compared to like a Skoda or a Volkswagen. Like, that's just plain facts. Like, you can't argue with that. Regardless how expensive it is to maintain, whatever, yada, yada, yada. But like, it's a German product at the end of the day. It's going to be posh. It's going to be luxurious. So like, the people who are in the comments like, oh, Endeavor this, Endeavor that, Jeep Compass this. I still don't get how can they like argue with a review which says it isn't meant to compete with them. It's just a posh vehicle. That's it. That's the end of the story. So yeah, I mean, I don't know. What do you think about it? Like, I know you haven't driven it, Srinath, but what do you think about it?
I just felt they've completely, I want to be, you know, I don't want to be mean about it, but I think it up. I think they can, if they, you know, brought out a car that could compete with the Venue or something that could compete with the Duster, that would still attract people, because Skoda, except for the Rapid, I don't think they're doing that well sales-wise. The whole reason being, they always appeal to the richer class of people. People who had money, people who had 20 lakhs of money. So Skoda, if they wanted to sell more cars, they could have brought a smaller car out. The whole thing with car workers, I was never into the space. I don't know how it drives and how it looks. Even I like the way it looks, but I just feel it's just too drab and boring for me. It would be a car I would never own. And it can't off-road. It's not as good as the Octavia on the road. And now the Octavia, the LNK, is a much better price. It's a much better car for the price. For 22 lakhs, whatever you get. So this is one area I don't have much to say. So I leave it to you guys because you've driven it.
Yeah, I mean, in that way, if like you're talking about it, they've actually kind of messed it up. Like, I hope like Apna, that Akoyashkar doesn't see this, but they have kind of messed it up. Like, it's first of all, it's quite expensive, and like, I get where people are coming from, but then you have to understand it's not meant to appeal to like to that sort of market. But I think so. What Skoda is trying to do is they're trying to capitalize on the ongoing trends. Like, everyone's into SUVs for some reason right now, and like, this Karoq is like the best example of what SUVs have come down to. Like, in the early 2000s and 90s, SUVs, like, they were four-wheel drive, massive. Like, you could fit, like, a whole village inside them. Now, they've come down to, you know, like, something like a compact SUV with, like, which you can hardly fit five people in properly. And the Karoq is a good product. As a product, I don't think it has any flaws, because they're not trying to aim for, like, those off-road junkies, like, who go on boulders in Lonavala just to take a picture with their Jeep Compass. They're meant for like people who are going to office every day and driven by a driver. So like, I think so that's the kind of customer they're looking for. Yeah. What do you think, Bhavneet?
The Skoda is basically an Octavia for a paranoid man that thinks, "Arey sedan hai bhai, ghisega yaar raste pe." It's basically that. It's not meant to go anywhere off the road. It's really nice, uneventful, peaceful. It's a Q3 without the fun.
Even the Q3 isn't that fun. Like, what can
you do? What's fun about a Q3? Please explain.
Exactly. Like, how
left in the Q3 was there in the Q3 is not even there.
Understandable. I get what you're saying.
Like, yeah. I don't, not like performance wala fun, but like all the other quirky good stuff that you get with an Audi. That's
not there.
Okay, so my next question is for the second person who was sort of roasted in the... Not roasted, I mean, people attacked him in the comments. It's Bhavneet. And especially when you reviewed the rider, the Rapid Rider. I mean, I really like that car. I think it's like pretty...
I didn't get basic. Quite a lot of hate.
If I'm not wrong, somebody... To quote someone, a great person from YouTube. I can't hear you, Bhavneet.
Some people called me skinny, but that's it.
No. It was about the car. You called it bare bones, and they were like, how can it be bare bones, man? It has like a radio.
They are not listening to the video, and they just get so enraged. But the thing is, we were test driving, not the bare-boned one. We were test driving the style, I think. And the rider was the bare-boned one for 2 lakhs cheaper than a Polo TSI Highline. And that's what I mentioned. And someone just went off on me. I mean, but like, how can I... What can I do?
And that's what I'm trying... Like, I don't understand, bro. Like, in one video, they're like...
Don't listen.
In one video, like, all of them are like, oh... Like, I mean, in the Karoq video, dude, like, it has a virtual cockpit. It has a panoramic sunroof. It has a lot of other shit which most cars, like the Jeep Compass and everything, don't have. And they start cribbing about, like, oh, you know, like, oh, this is that. And when we call a Rapid Rider, which actually is, it's basically a taxi car, like, if you think about it, except the engine. It has a radio, it has a gearbox, it has a steering wheel. That's it. Doesn't have anything else inside. And aircon. 4 feature it has. And we were like, oh, like, how is it bare bones and all? Like, compared to, like, what people are selling today, like, if you buy a Honda City and all, it's going to be significantly cheaper than a Rapid Rider, and you will get a little bit more features. So comparing it to that, then it is bare bones. Like, people are just too anal about... Indian people are too anal about their features, their fuel economy, and everything like that, which is like, I don't know what to say about it. Like, I think about it when buying a car, like, I'll probably spend this much petrol, I'll get this, I'll get that. But like, you have to drive the car, you have to understand the car, what it's meant for, then comment about it. And it's just like, yeah, people just see the car, he hears one thing saying, oh, it's bare bones. They're like, oh, how did he call it bare bones and all. So they just go off.
Enough shitting on our viewers.
No, it's not our viewers. It's not our viewers. Like, it's just
random.
It's a handful of people. It's not all of them. Of course, it's not all of them.
Yeah, I mean, there was like a lot of positive. Positive. Okay, Srinath has had his hand up for a while. Srinath, you go first. Yeah. Then Bhavneet, you go.
The thing is, we Indians, whenever we review a car, we have completely different problem compared to people who are reviewing cars abroad, because our standards are way too low. Because these people when we say these cars are bare bones, because they haven't experienced a car which has features like 6 airbags, because they're pretty standard in other countries. We have airbags as a feature in our cars. Okay, so when you mention a car which has, like, say 4 airbags, people go mad. Like, oh, and they have nothing to do with, because they haven't experienced features like, we don't even have lane keeping assist. We don't have any of those features, which are kind of standard in cars in US. So it just comes to say, these people who have driven a Swift ZX, right? When they drive a Rapid and when they see a touchscreen, they're like, oh my God, for 7.5, this is the bargain of the year. But again, when you have driven much more expensive and costlier cars, I think this is pretty bare bones. And the steering wheel, that's the most boring steering wheel I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, Bhavneet.
I don't have anything to say. I really like my fans.
Again, we are only talking about the Rapid, the Skoda Rapid, the base edition, rider edition. We are not talking about the higher end spec car you drove, Bhavneet. So that is pretty well equipped.
Yeah, that's basically into Highline.
Yes. So it just comes to show, people in YouTube, they're just smelling for controversy. They they don't end up that they don't listen to they don't actually understand what the car feels like or how the car drives, but they spot this and they point it out to you because it's free. Criticism is free in YouTube or in social media. It won't cost them anything, and it's not like we are going to reply back to it or we are going to do anything about it.
Some people do give quite a lot of good constructive criticism, actually, which is more than the small pack of annoying cunts.
I agree. Yeah. I mean, we've gotten some good constructive criticism on the videos, which we actually will implement, hopefully, in the next iteration of the videos. But I just came along this really stupid comment right now while checking the YouTube comments. So I'm not going to take the name of who it is. So it's on your video, Bhavneet, on the Superb. So this guy is comparing a Superb to Endeavor. He's like saying, oh, for 35 to 40 lakhs, my choice will be an Endeavor. What do you think about that? And tell us your experience with the Superb also.
The Superb is a car that is really, that I can't find a direct competitor to. I mean, apart from WAG Group and an A4 long wheelbase in China, I don't see anything else that, I mean, and compete in India, so I don't. Camry, yes. But I'd prefer a Superb. Those Camrys don't seem to be very reliable, huh? Those hybrid systems. Yes.
Bhavneet, bro, the Camry hybrids are pretty sorted, man. Like, you don't need to worry. Like, I'll tell you who's bought those cars. It's been bought by a certain very famous business community. And when they come to know, oh my God, it's giving me 24 kilometers per liter. This business community, oh yes, I have to buy this car. And they've sold very few numbers. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, the Skoda's Superb, the one you reviewed, is infinitely better because it just comes equipped like the fit, like that's not even so much talking about, like the Karoq, the fit and finish has no comparison. Like, it's really good. Like, you feel like you're sitting in an Audi, or you feel like sitting in a premium car. When you sit in a Ford Endeavor, you know you're sitting in a Ford Endeavor and that, yeah, you're going to go through some very bad roads. And don't get me wrong, Ford Endeavors are great for what they are. But if you're living in Pune and you're going to office and coming back, what good is a Ford Endeavor? You might as well have a very comfortable car with these features.
Exactly. But actually, the newer Ford Endeavors are not that bad inside, but they do not compare to the Superb at all. And if luxury is what you're searching for, that Superb gives a really good deal. However, there are a little bit of plastics that you can really, that are very noticeable in the bottom of the cabin. And a little, and it's super long. Like, it's a yacht. The rear section is literally so difficult to search that if it wasn't for those sensors, parking would be a nightmare. Would be a complete nightmare with that car. Otherwise, I'd sleep behind in that car, long distance.
Yeah, and see, the thing is, it's a sedan, bro. Like, at the end of the day, like, when you're going for a business meeting, like, if you're someone important, like, you're staying in Bombay, you're going to a business meeting somewhere in Bandra, would you rather pull up in, like, a brash-looking American SUV with, like, giant Ford written on the front, or would you come in, like, a nice, classy looking, you know, like German sedan, Czech Republican sedan? Yeah, I mean, so like the Superb, when it comes to like class and, you know, like just plain premium luxury and all of that, I think so it's, there's nothing to it. Like the Camry, in terms of, you know, like the luxury aspect of that car, just general looks, road presence and all, it doesn't even come close. Of course, reliability, fuel economy, that's a different thing. But when you're looking at a car which is 35 to 40 lakhs, I mean, do you really care about fuel economy that much? I don't think so. So, I mean, yeah, in that price bracket, if I'm looking for a car like that, For sure. Superb. 100%. What about you? It has the same... Srinath, what about you? What do you think? It has this, basically the same internals as a VRS. So what do you think about it?
I think we should not even be comparing the VRS to this. That's just doing... That's injustice to the VRS. See, this engine has a different role. But just imagine a guy wearing blazer and suit. He just did a $50 million car deal. He comes out and he's trying to climb in his endeavor. Itna sa height. And he's trying to reach for the grab handles and trying to fit in. The comparison between an Endeavor and the Superb, it just says everything about our market. There is no variety in our market. Everything comes down to the price. Both these cars do completely different things. But just goes to say, our mentality is like this. Because we don't have any options. Then when you don't have any options, it purely comes down to the price, which gives you better value. And Bhavneet, Corolla is literally the opposite of a VAG group. It would last you for decades and still won't give you any problems. The Camry. Oh, shit, okay.
On a car that are supposed to run a really long time and run a while, doesn't happen. Those Camrys will break down.
How much do we have?
I'm giving them a shot.
Do we have time?
Huh? Yeah,
we have time. Because I want to explore one topic, okay? And this is a topic which will gain popularity in the future, but maybe not now. Now, we are talking about electric cars. So many brands are coming out with electric cars. While people haven't actually found a way to dispose batteries. So, when you have these many electric cars coming in, what would you do with the batteries? All the used batteries. Because your phone battery, it will last you for 2 or 3 years. And after that, you either switch it for a brand new phone or you change your battery. Still, what would you do with all these car batteries? Let's say in 5 years, we'll have majority of, at least some of the population driving the electric car. And 10 years after that, we'll have all these cars having non-functioning batteries or used batteries, worn out batteries. What would you do with these batteries?
Okay, I'll go first here. So, what Srinath is saying here, I mean, I get the point. I mean, the pollution factor is also pretty high because mining these batteries, first of all, environmentally, it's pretty bad. And there's also an ethical question here because at least when you pump out that fuel from the ground or from the sea, from the middle of nowhere, we know who's pumping our fuel out. It's pretty old people. They at least have an engineering degree and they're pumping it out. These batteries, which we get from these mines in Africa, they're like 6-year-old kids, 7-year-old kids falling off, dying. But okay, now I'm going to refer to some studies here, which they're pretty credible. They were done at MIT. And there was one study which found out that if you use an electric car for more than 2 years and you use the same internal combustion car for 2 years, so all the pollution which goes into making all that will recover in 2 years, right? And the internal combustion car still keeps polluting. So that's a very new study which has come and it's supporting the electric car thing. But then again, just as Srinath mentioned,
what do we do with all these batteries then?
And also there's
Yeah, Bhavneet, go.
Lithium ion.
Yeah.
Lithium disposal. Usually, majority of the world's lithium is disposed in China. And majority of the world's lithium is also mined in Africa, China, and another continent, which I do not remember.
Australia.
But disposal is super dangerous. Recycling is pretty much impossible or very difficult. And it's highly toxic. So China is the only one who's actually come up and decided to do most of it. And currently, the world is trying to move away from China. So it creates an even bigger dilemma. So I don't know where it's going to go, if China is going to capitalize from it, or if the entire planet is going to allow China to capitalize from it, because the industry is massive. It's the car industry, transport industry, basically, that wants to be electrified. You never know. It's very, very uncertain times. Go for it, Shira.
I really feel this electric cars, they're a phase in our, the automotive space. They're only a phase. I think the real future is hydrogen powered cars, the hydrogen fuel cell cars, or in the distant future, it might be solar.
It can contain hydrogen.
There's a car called the Mira or the Mura.
Yeah. The thing about those cars are basically hydrogen bombs.
Bhavneet.
Yes.
Have you checked out that new Toyota hydrogen car?
Yeah, but how does it run? It's not like it's on compression, right? Do you know what happens when you compress hydrogen?
Yeah, I mean, bro, like if you get, see, that's the thing with technology, right? Like how Sina just said, like electric might, I mean, I think electric is here to stay. Like I'll tell you why, because initially when electric cars came, everyone was like, what is this, bro? Like nobody's gonna do this. And now you see like the most sophisticated people, like petrol cars are something which they like to keep, like, because driving them is fun. But the thing with electric cars is they are fast, bro. Like those Teslas and all, like, I mean, I think I was watching the Joe Rogan podcast and he was in his Porsche 911 chilling on this thing and a Tesla just like gaps him. It's a $40,000 car.
Okay. So I think like we've discussed a lot. Like I think we've clocked an hour now and I think it's time we wrap it up. So we're always open to discuss any of your questions. You can put them down on the comments of this podcast. We're also going to upload this podcast on Google Podcasts as well as Spotify. So you can check us out there. If you don't want to watch a YouTube video and you're on a run and you just want to plug on a podcast and watch four people just talk about cars, you can do that as well. So yeah, I think this is Hamad and we're signing off for the Fuel Up Podcast.
Bye-bye.